I'm very happy to see so many people here in spite of the bad weather. And I'd like to thank you for that. We're very excited to have P.Sainath here to talk about the People's Archive of Rural India and the work that they do, and why it is so vital to write and talk about rural India in mainstream media. Although this may not be required, but I'd like to take this opportunity to introduce him. P.Sainath is the founding editor of the People's Archive of Rural India. The archive is an outcome of his 3 decades plus experience in journalism, including a quarter century of reporting from rural India. But he aims to address the complete failure of the corporate media to cover 2/3 of the country's population. Their aim is to report and record what is easily the most complex part of the planet. P.Sainath, formerly the rural affairs editor of The Hindu, writer and journalism teacher, is the 2007 winner of the Raman Magsaysay Award, Asia's most prestigious prize. He has also won the World Media Summit Global Award for Excellence 2014 in public welfare reporting. He was the first reporter in the world to win Amnesty International's Global Award for Human Rights Journalism in its inaugural year in 2000. He has taught at journalism schools in India and abroad, mentoring students as well as training media professionals. His book Everybody Loves a Good Drought, now in its 43rd print, was declared a Penguin Classic in January 2013. The book is being used in over 100 universities in India and abroad. His photo archive of black and white images from rural India is being digitized. One part of that, titled Visible Work, Invisible Women, is now on Pari as a fully curated online exhibition. I'd like to invite the Dean of the School of Media and Cultural Studies, Dr. Anjali Montero, to present her with a token of our appreciation. Standing at the back can come in the front and sit here. Yeah. Also, I'd like to inform everyone that we are streaming this on Facebook from the page of the Center of Media and Cultural Studies. So you can share it if you would like to do that. Without any further delay, I would like to invite Sir to.
Thank you very much. Delighted to be here. The average national daily newspaper in this country, it's another conversation what a national daily stands for. Essentially, it means any newspaper that has 2 editions, one of which comes out of Delhi. And the average national daily, its front page devotes 0.67% of space to rural India. And that's a 5-year average from data culled by the Center for Media Studies in Delhi. 66% of that front page consists of Delhi. And you see one side of Delhi, okay? One part of Delhi. The other 3 metros together don't add up to 15 odd percent, maybe don't add up to 20%. There are, apart from the 4 major metros, there are in all about 50 urban agglomerations, cities with a population of more than 1 million. In the 2011 census, 46. Since then, a few more have crossed that mark. They don't appear at all. So it's not that it's only rural India we don't cover. We don't cover urban India either. Okay. One city gets 66%. However, it's interesting. And what about the inside pages? Typically, the CMS data for the last several years finds that health, education, agriculture, environment, forest, all of these put together don't equal what entertainment and crime get. That is a particular kind of crime. However, in the last few days, there have been several editorials on rural India, all of them urging the government very strongly not to raise the minimum support price for farmers and their produce. In other words, they don't say it, but they are saying, telling the government, do not implement the Swaminathan Commission's report. They don't mention the Swaminathan Commission report, but they're saying that, you know, essentially they're saying don't pamper these guys. Yeah? And the guys who are, and girls who are being pampered have in between 1995 and 2015, about 3,10,000 of them have committed suicide. Indeed, the National Crime Records Bureau has not published farmers' suicide data for 2 years now. Every year it's to be published by June 30th. 2 years they have not published the data. 2 years before that, they massaged the data so badly, got themselves into such complexities, they don't know how to get out of it. And 2 years, between 2011 and 2014, when they changed the methodology altogether in 2014, between those years, political counts started happening. You know, the farm suicides numbers that you read in your newspapers, any idea where they come from? They don't come from the police. They don't come from the National Crime Records Bureau. They come from the revenue department of your government. Why revenue department? Because they need to keep the numbers down, because the revenue department has to pay out compensations. Right? Sometimes there are numbers just created in the chief minister's office for the assembly session to face the fighting and shouting over there. But for 2 years, the National Crime Records Bureau has not published farm suicide data. They might publish it any day now if they have figured out yet another methodological twist to keep it down. What did they do in 2011, as the issue was really burning? State government after state government started declaring zero farmer suicides. So the country just became a farmer's paradise. There were no suicides. I mean, it's normal in this country for 8 to 10% of a occupational group or gender-wise or whatever. The general suicides account to a percentage of the population of a particular group. You can never have zero. Chhattisgarh in 2011 had one decade of data, in the official data of the government of India, showing that on average 1,555 farmers have committed suicide every year for the preceding 10 years. In 2011, they declared zero suicides. Cold turkey, they went from 1,500 a year to zero a year. Then Didi declared in West Bengal that when I am CL, how can there ever be a suicide in West Bengal? So West Bengal declared zero. It had an average of about 800, 850, which was within the parameters of that occupational group nationally. But suddenly it went from 850 to zero. But in the 2014 NCRB, 12 states and 6 union territories declared zero farmer suicides. So the numbers kept falling as the suicides kept rising. So where did those other bodies go? In the suicides, in the farmer's suicides, there were anyway serious flaws and exclusions. Already, about 7 or 8 major groups were already largely excluded, not totally, but largely excluded. The biggest exclusion in farm suicides numbers is of women farmers. Do you know that if you look at the data of the HCRB, which is the only authentic thing we have, Haryana and Punjab are the best states to be a woman farmer in. No woman farmer ever commits suicide in Haryana and Punjab because they don't accept women as farmers. Okay, then you look at the column of general suicides by women in those two states, it's explosive. So you're shifting bodies to other columns. Okay? In 2014, when the new government came in, the methodology was in the NCRB is a decent institution. It only collates data and analyzes it. And I'm saying that you should only look at numbers, never look at what they give you. Never look at what they give you as reasons and stuff. It isn't for the government to tell you or policemen to tell you what the reasons are. Okay? So, in 2014, one major exclusion is that of women farmers. Incidentally, but that just reflects not the prejudice of the HCRB, it reflects your societal prejudices, how it's counted at the ground level. Know this, well over 60% of all work in agriculture is done by women. But we don't accept women as farmers. They are farmers' wives or daughters or sisters or dependents. But the fact is, the bulk of work in agriculture is done by women in this country. And the proportion of particular tasks is astonishing. Paddy transplantation, which is a very, very difficult, absolutely a painful job, where you are spending hours bent over double and trying to put the and transplant your thing in the correct pouch through brown, dark water, standing up to your shins with all sorts of insects and creatures and floating in that water. Paddy transplantation, between 90 and 95% of it is done by women. Seeding, some other obscene percentage. Transportation of crop from field to home, 80% and above by women. So all of this a huge amount of the work in agriculture, and women, by the way, are barred from plowing ritually, because that asserts the male control over the process of agriculture. So a hell of a lot of women actually plow because the man isn't there. In hundreds of thousands of families where the male has migrated, the women do plow. Yeah? But they are ritually excluded from the idea of plowing so that then it retains socially a male control over agriculture. Now every one of you sitting here, when you think of agriculture, the first image that comes to mind is man with plow, right? You think of man, if it's Punjab, you think of man on tractor, right? It is, the labor of that occupation is female dominated. Anyway, so, but since we don't record them as, except in a few states where the property rights situation is slightly different, and therefore, we end up showing that between 10 and 12% of farmer suicides are by women. But that's not true. I'm not saying that they are higher than male suicides. They're not. But they're a hell of a lot more than what you see there. Where do these numbers go when you play with the methodology? All of you as students or postgraduate students and whatnot, and all of you, when you do your tables and your data arrangement and analysis, you know there's a column in your table called others. So in 2014, the 2015 report shows you the 2014 data. In the 2014 data, the number of farm suicides fell by more than half in the five major states, now six, because Andhra is since divided into Andhra and Telangana. In the six major states, farm suicides fell by more than 50%. The others column of those five states went up by 128%. In Karnataka, which is one of those six states, farm suicides fell by 62%. The others column went up by 245%. So then they got themselves into this tangle. They readjusted the methodology again the next year. Now the problem with doing this is that backward comparisons become impossible. The methodology is, you can't compare anymore 2014 with 2004. You can't do that. There's no longitudinal data. By the way, there was one institution in this country which provided longitudinal data on the most crucial of our issues, nutrition and hunger, especially nutrition. It was called the National Nutrition Monitoring Bureau in Hyderabad, the NNMB. 2012, it did a study. The results were out in 2014-15. It said that rural Indians were eating many items, consuming much less in many items than they did 40 years ago, including milk, magnesia, vitamins. Now, how was this problem sorted out by the government of India? It shut down the National Nutrition Monitoring Bureau. Did you even read about it in your newspapers or hear about it on your Five Wise Men panel discussions? It was reported on the inside pages of a few newspapers, you'll find it. They just shut down the National Nutrition Monitoring Bureau. The NCRB became such a headache for them, its data, and I am blamed by several of the NCRB statisticians with some justice for getting them into the line of fire. They're very decent and respectable people. They haven't fudged your data. It's the format imposed on them from outside and the mischief that state governments play politically. So what did the government do? 2017, it shut down the NCRB and merged it into the Bureau of Police Research and Development, the BPRD. And there was such a backlash against that because suddenly all the states were without their useful data. So then they demerged it 2 months ago. It's all about hiding the corpse. Yeah. So they demerged. So now there is again an NCRB, and who knows what absurd data is going to come out of what was once an institution that provided us useful data. But what you do read in the newspapers is about the MSP. Don't raise it. Don't pamper these guys. The other time you'll read lots of editorials is when they write editorials on these loan waivers are a very bad thing. You've given a loan waiver of 23,000 crores. You've given a loan waiver of nearly 30,000 crores to just Vijay Mallya and Nirav Modi. The NPAs of banks, which everybody writes about, your media do not tell you that over 70% of those NPAs have come from corporates and business houses. They've come from corporations and business houses. The amounts owed, what they will not publish for you the roles of the top defaulters in banks. There they will say, banking secrecy laws demand it. In the village, there is no such secrecy. They come and nail the list of defaulters to the panchayat door. Okay, to the notice board in the panchayat. If you owe the bank 40,000 rupees, you have no confidentiality. You owe them 4,000 crores, you have confidentiality. So the other is about this loan waiver stuff and what people are actually, what are the farmers actually demanding? Loan waiver is one element. I hope all of you know, or that's another thing where the data has disappeared. Loan, in the entire history of this country, there have been two loan waivers nationally for farmers. There were more in the British colonial Raj. Yeah, the first state in this country to pass an indebtedness, elimination of indebtedness act was the 1934 Act of Punjab, which in 1937 was emulated by Madras province. The only government in this country that has tried to make some use of that law was in 2006 when Prabhat Patnaik became the deputy chairman of the State Planning Board of Kerala. They created a similar law. Now, there have been two loan waivers, one by Chaudhary Devilal in 1989, and that was 10,000 rupees per farmer flat across the country, all farms. In 2008, the UPA government introduced what I felt then and said then was a very partial, very biased, very, very disturbingly mischievous waiver. Because by the way, the waivers only covered bank loans. Whereas in the period of liberalization in India, banks have moved away from the peasantry. And the peasants have been forced more and more to turn to the sahukar and the money lender. That debt has not been touched. That debt has not been touched. In the British Raj, that was the only debt. There were no nationalized banks in the British Raj. So when your waiver came in British Raj, the British Raj was willing to do something that was going to hurt its class allies, the moneylenders. In Punjab 2017, when Captain Amrinder Singh came to power, he came on a promise of complete loan waiver for the peasantry. After that, 6 months after coming to power, they waived loans conditionally on banks, cooperatives, even a certain number of private banks, but they did not touch the loan, 17,000 crore debt owed by the peasantry to the Arhatiyas, the commission agents and money lenders. That has not been touched by the Punjab government. Those people are ministers in the cabinet. Like 10 years ago, the chief minister of the state, Vilasrao Deshmukh, was fined 10 lakhs by the Supreme Court for having aided and abetted. Do you know this? He was fined 10 lakhs by the Supreme Court of India for having aided and abetted a money lender in Vidarbha. Actually, the court in Nagpur, the Nagpur bench of the Bombay High Court, charged him 25,000 rupees fine. He went in appeal to the Supreme Court to have his honor. Unfortunately, Justice Ashok Ganguly, who heard that case, said that 25,000 is an absurd amount and made it 10 lakhs. By the way, the state government paid it for him. It was his personal action as an individual that protected a lead Vidarbha's biggest money lender. So you're looking at the Karza, but there is a Karza Mafi. Every year, if you read your budget, for the corporate world and the top 1%. That also, they have scrapped that section of the budget by renaming it, and I'm blamed for that also. It used to be called Statement of Revenue Foregone. Have you heard of that, NHR? Statement of Revenue. You know what was the revenue foregone annually when the last such figure was out in 2015? For the top 1% of the population? 5,34,000 crores. Go look up the budget on online in the TISS.in website. 5,34,000 crores. 78,000 crores was waiver of direct corporate income tax. 2,49,000 crores was the waiver on excise duties. The rest 2 lakh something crores was the waiver on customs duties. And the single biggest item in customs duties waiver was not oil, not petrol. What was it? I mean, it was gold, diamonds and jewelry. All Aam Aadmi items. I think oil was a separate bill, but in the customs duties waiver, the biggest chunk was that. The data is only available between 2006, when a group of MPs forced the government to start publishing it, because it's a constitutional obligation, it's a legal obligation of the government to publish that data, to 2015, in 9 years, you know how much that waiver comes to? The amount, look at the title of the annexure says, statement of revenue foregone. It, government is saying, we have foregone this revenue for you. Yeah. So, the total between 2006 and 2015 was 42.3 trillion rupees. Can you accommodate 12 zeros? Do you know what you could do in 42.3 trillion rupees? You could run the NREGS for 105 years. You could run the National Food Security Act for 31 years. All of this you could do. Then Mr. Jaitley and his whiz kid, the Arvind Subramaniam, whom everybody lamented was leaving India, they changed the name of the annexure to tax, real impact of revenue, whatever, from tax incentives. The semantics of it is beautiful. If you give 5 rupees to a poor farmer, that's a subsidy. You give 5 billion to Vijay Mallya, that's an incentive. Yeah. Even their loans are called non-performing assets. Not bad debts. The sheer levels of inequality that have grown are astonishing and beyond belief. A simple, you know, maybe some of you will just move in a little here and then the others can come in. You can come here also, it's okay with me. You can come onto the stage, that's fine. Yeah. There's a simple marker, simple couple of markers that you can look at for the astonishing growth of inequality in India in the last several years. The Forbes billionaires list comes in, and in year 2000 you had $8 billionaires. In year 2012, the year we conducted our socio-economic caste census, 2017 Forbes, the Forbes list of billionaires, we had 101. That is, between 2012 and 2017, it doubled. And this year, Forbes tells me, my favorite website, Forbes, it's bookmarked. You know, it's a very aspirational thing. Maybe one day you'll find your name. So, in 2018, March, India records 121 dollar billionaires. And these 121 individuals in a population of 1.3 billion account for 22% of your GDP. They account for more than a fifth of your gross domestic product. Check it out, it's on the Forbes list. 121 individuals. And lo, one individual's name led all the rest. You know who that is?
Mr. Mukesh Ambani, in 12 months, remember that, between 2017 March and 2018 March, you went from $101 to $121 billionaires. But within those billionaires, one name, Mr. Ambani, in 12 months added $16.9 billion to his wealth. If you want to know how much that is at current rates, that's about 1,15,000 crores. Now, he must have worked very hard to add 1,15,000 crores. And, well, he may have, but I mean, you can believe that, but less charitable minds like my own believe it happened with small, subtle policy changes, like those favoring Jio and allowing it to virtually kill its competitors, things like that. Okay? 1,15,000 crores. You know, to add $16.9 billion, please try thinking of anything that can bring you $16.9 billion in 12 months. Because it means that you added $1.95 million every hour. Every 60 minutes, you added $1.95 million. Now, I started thinking, you know, that, as I said, it's an aspirational thing. What about the Aam Aadmi or Aam Aurat or whatever? If they want to generate $16.9 billion in 12 months, what would it take? So I took the lowest common denominator, the minimum wage as given for the national average wage as found in the NREGS. Now the NREGS wage has major differences. Kerala and Punjab are very high. Odisha and Chhattisgarh are very low. But there's an average in that period of 12 months of 161 rupees a day nationally. Here's the deal. It would take 18.7 million Indian laborers 365 days on the NREGS without break. No Diwali, Christmas, Saturdays, Sundays, nothing. 365 days without break, then they could also generate 16.9 billion. Okay. When you've got that kind of inequality, you have a problem that is incredibly greater than you ever imagined. Okay. And today, I believe, the country, especially the countryside, is in far greater ferment than I have known it to be in my many years as a rural reporter, which is essentially what I am. Okay. And you are not kept informed or served by your media at all. Okay. You have what you read when you open your newspaper is a top lead editorial saying, don't give this additional MSP to the farmer. It distorts the markets. You know, do the masses, do markets exist to serve the masses or do masses exist to serve the market? In 2014, this government came present, just like Amrinder Singh in Punjab. This government, the present central government, came to power promising Swaminathan Commission's first recommendation, cost of production plus 50%. In 2015, 1 year after coming to power, it gave an affidavit in the courts and an RTI reply saying, this is not possible. Okay, it's not possible. It would distort the markets. That's the reply they gave. It would distort market prices. Having come to power promising that. 2016, Radha Mohan Singh, your agriculture minister, denies that a promise was ever made. 2017, they tell us, we've gone far ahead of the Swaminathan Commission. Look at Shivraj Singh Chauhan in Madhya Pradesh, who has introduced a system of weightage and support price that goes way beyond anything Swaminathan said. In fact, a book was released by two eminent economists in the India International Center on the Madhya Pradesh model. It was released the same day. Five farmers were shot dead in Mandsaur in Madhya Pradesh protesting about prices. That is 2018 January budget speech, paragraphs 13 and 14 of the finance minister's budget speech. Mr. Jaitley said, Swaminathan Commission, we have already implemented it. Well, 3 days ago they implemented it again. If you have already implemented it, what was the point of making an announcement that you are going to implement it? Dr. Swaminathan himself has clarified that what the government has announced, not implemented, what it has announced is not what he recommended. And it's not just Swaminathan. There was a thing called the National Commission for Farmers, which came to be known as the Swaminathan Commission because he was the chairman and the leading light, no question about that. But it was a very broad consultative process, and what he put it very well. He said it's not cost of production plus 50%. He said it is not COP plus 50%. What they have announced is COP plus 15%. And the trick lies in how you define cost of production. There are many, many, many measures of cost of production. I think one of your own professors here in this institution has written very well and very knowledgeably about it, Professor Ramakumar. Look at his writing on the issues of the MSP. He'll show you that there are many, many methods of calculation, but three broadly that the CACP, the Commission of Agricultural Prices, blah, blah, was concerned with. One was called A2, which consisted simply of calculating the input costs, paid out input costs on a particular season. Then there was A2 plus FL, which meant input costs plus imputed plus family labor. What was the value of the family labor? The third method was COP2 plus 50%, which is COP2, which is what the Swaminathan Commission recommended, which is comprehensive cost of production, which would include all these family labor input costs and also have rental value of land, the interest on payments, all of this, just as any business in the world calculates it. Why should the farmers be denied the right to calculate it? Okay. So if you go by COP, let me give you, suppose it was, you took the cheapest variety of wheat. At A2, the cost of production would be 500 rupees on. At A2 plus FL, it would be 800 rupees. At comprehensive cost of production of the cheapest variety, it would be 1200 rupees. So then your MSP would be 1800 rupees. 1200 plus 600 plus 50%. All this stuff, they're taking the A2 and the A2 plus FL, and you have a media dying to be hoodwinked, okay? Willing to do that kind of propaganda. In fact, owned by the very people whose propaganda it is. And that's, you know, a whole generation has grown up completely distanced from its roots. One third of the population completely distanced from its roots in the other two thirds. Rural India, which is in such ferment, in such agony today. Remember, your billionaires earned, you know, they were accounted for 22% of your GDP. What is the income of an average farm household in this country? The last figure we have from the NSS, 6,426 rupees, $95, $90 now on the current rate, for a family of five. That means individually per capita under 1300 rupees. What is the situation of earning in rural India generally? socio-economic caste census. 75% of rural households, there are 179 million rural households in the 2011 census. 75% of the households, the main breadwinner takes home less than 5,000. In 90%, if you raise the bench to 90,000 of the household, 90% of rural households, main breadwinner takes home less than 10,000. What percentage of Indian rural households have the main breadwinner taking home more than 10,000? 8%. And that's 8% general population, all population. If we look at Adivasis and Dalits, it's 4% or less. Now, who are those 4% of Adivasis and Dalits who have a, most of them are government servants. They'll be PWD workers, railway workers, bank workers, okay, working in the collectorate. They are the ones who will be taking home more than 10,000. And those are the jobs that are being shut out, closed massively. Those are the jobs that will go as you privatize the banks, as you knock off the railways, as you stop recruiting and keep lakhs, allow lakhs of vacancies to remain in the government services, in the public services of government. Yeah. So that's the situation. Look at that. A person can earn 1,15,000 crores, add to his wealth, and others, five members of a farming family, per capita income under 1,300, or household. By the way, that household income of 6,426 is not only from agriculture, it's from all sources. Every one of you knows that the average farm in India, as in much of the world, one brother will stay on the farm. Two, three brothers will go out. One will work as a chaprasi in the collector's office. Another as a primary school teacher. Yet another as an insurance agent. They send remittances to the farm. And at harvest time, they claim their share. Women don't figure in all this at all. Okay, by the way. But that's how farming runs. That's how many households survive. Now, in that kind of inequality, you really need to ask yourself, why do I know so little about what the heck is happening in this country? It has to do with that gigantic socialization apparatus called your media. No newspaper or channel in this country has a full-time labor correspondent. When I started my first day in journalism in late 1980, most of the major newspapers, the national dailies in Delhi, because I began my journalism in Delhi, had labor correspondents. They had agriculture correspondents and district correspondents who went to the mandi and reported from there. Today, no major newspaper has a full-time agriculture correspondent who covers agriculture. We have many people called agriculture correspondents. They cover the agriculture ministry. Sometimes they just cover the agriculture minister, as in the case of Mr. Pawar. Yeah. They don't cover agriculture. They don't cover the farming process. They don't cover the life of an agricultural laborer. They don't cover what happens at the mandi, how the cheating, the swindling, the shortchanging is done. They don't cover any of that. Listen, when you're making a statement, when and media as a whole say that we will not have a full-time labor correspondent, we will not have a full-time agriculture correspondent, you are saying 75% of the population don't make news. That's your statement. You're saying 75% of this, they do once in 5 years at election time. And that's why you get such lousy election coverage, because you're going out and talking to people whose minds you don't know at all. Right? We haven't been in touch with those people. We have no idea what they're thinking. Rural India is an extraordinary place, incredible in its beauty, horrible in its barbarity. Both realities are true. There is no such thing as an Indian reality. There are Indian realities in multiplicity and in capital letters. There are things that are actually much worse than they were 30 years ago in the countryside. Like say, the resurgence of extreme casteist violence. Okay, you know, I will tell you this, the Kharks of Haryana were not so strong and powerful 30 years ago. They weren't. They used to be afraid of police. Today, the DGP and IGP of police in Haryana proudly say we are CARP members. They proclaim that the CARP is a moral institution. It's come with the rise of fundamentalism in your society. Okay, many, many horrible, ugly things have resurfaced. But the same rural India also has many extraordinary, incredible things about it that, to my mind, as a journalist, there is no more magical place on earth. Think about it. 833 million human beings speaking 780 living languages. Seven of those languages spoken by more than 50 million human beings. Three of them spoken by more than 80 million human beings. One of them spoken by more than 500 million human beings. At the other end of the spectrum, there is the language of Jeru in the Andamans down to its last speaker, one old lady. When she goes, it's gone. There is in Saimar, recorded by the People's Archive of India, in Tripura, seven speakers of a language called Saimarese, of the Saimarese tribals. There are many, many Adivasi languages which have just between 10,000 and 200,000, 300,000 speakers. These are part of your language, your history, your culture, your legacy. They're dying very fast. Okay. So they're dying very fast because in the past 50 years, 225 Indian languages have died, according to the People's Linguistic Survey of India, chaired by Professor Ganesh Devi. 225 languages have died, many more. Part of the People's Archive of Rural India, which I never talked to you about, part of our mandate is to record every spoken Indian tongue. And by the way, we don't get into the debates of what is a dialect and what is a language. Everybody's language is a language to them. So we use the more democratic term of tongues. Everyone's got one. To give you another idea, look, the complexity of this language versus dialect debate is best seen when we talk about, say, Hindi. This is an invented and contrived language that is not 125 years old, not even 150, certainly not 150 years old. The great Indian languages of the north, the great Hindi belt languages are Avadhi, Bhojpuri, Maithili, Brajbhasha. These are the, you know, your Kabir and the Tulsis and the Sud, they didn't write in Hindi. They wrote in these languages. These are the languages of your culture, of your history in the north of India. We call them dialects. Yeah, and we laugh when we hear Lalu speak. He is speaking a classical Indian language that is more than 1,500 years old. Okay. But we've been socialized, brought up, educated in that way. The entire point about Indian education is that there isn't any. What you have is a training. And training for what? I haven't a clue. Okay? But it's a training, it's not an education. Yeah? And look at the kind of people now you have in charge of education, in the HRD. One namuna after the other. My favorite in all the crap that's going on, you may prefer the Tripura CM, but my favorite is my former police commissioner, Satyapal Singh. Satyapal Singh, as you know, is now famous for declaring and reiterating that Darwin spouted a lot of bullshit. By the way, I agree with him on two things, okay? I'll be fair to him. To the point that he says that Darwin is not above question, I entirely agree. Nobody is beyond big question, scientifically. Science also moves forward by questioning. He is also right. He said, essentially, Mr. Satyapal Singh said, Darwin's theory of the ascent of, or descent, whatever, of the human race is all wrong. I am not descended from apes. And nobody has anybody gone into the forest and seen apes turning into men? No, he's absolutely right. Nobody has gone into the forest and seen apes turning into men. That has to be conceded. But I think we live in privileged times when we get to see Satyapal Singh and so many of his ministerial colleagues attempt the reverse process with some degree of success. You have, the last talk that I went to, I received a message from one of my friends. I did the Neela Mishra Memorial Lecture in Delhi. And I got a message. You know, it tells you the kind of people who are decision making. And I got a message saying, P.S., I was speaking to a big audience for the Neela Mishra Memorial Lecture in Delhi. And I got a message from two so-called friends who said, P.S., how are you going to inspire all those young people out there? You want that talk to go big, don't you? So, suggestion, they wrote to me. Suggestion, move to center front stage. Place your paws on the floor and meet the Rathore fitness test. Your talk will go viral. Do 30 quick push-ups. Well, as I declined because I have nothing against push-ups, but I'm a lot better at put-downs. Now, where is in your educational content, in the textbooks, which I have begun to tell you that Pushpak Vimanam existed 20, 30,000 years ago? I have a grouse against the Tripura CM because the deputy CM also. My grouse is that why I prefer Satyapalji over them. Reveal that we have had the internet for 9,000 years. Nobody told me. I think our ancestors really disliked us. Now, in the midst of, just look at your newspapers and see the kind of stuff that you get about rural India, what it is. There's extraordinary stuff going on. But in the incredible, brutal transformation that is taking place, It's the beautiful and the valuable that is dying, and the reactionary and the barbaric that is coming on top, like the cops in Haryana. On the one hand, the Kanjivaram sari, the weaving is an art which we do not know how long it will last. Do you know there is not a single Tamilian weaver anymore? They're all Padmasharis from Telangana who are willing to work it. And what have you done with the Tamil weavers of, we have reskilled them. They're now driving auto rickshaws in Kanchipuram. Okay? People with 1,500 years of skills, we have reskilled them, you know, for huge technology to be driving an auto rickshaw. The People's Archive of Rural India came into being to fill this gigantic gap of what is. When 69% of your population you're not willing to cover, when you're not willing to look at, every day you are losing your history, you're losing your records, you're losing your traditions, and you're losing the good ones. The bad ones you are embracing and building them up like anything. One of our projects in the People's Archive of Rural India, I'm going to show you a clip. I'll show you many clips of 1 minute, but only one which is full 5 minutes. One of our projects is I'm being recording and talking to and filming the last living freedom fighters. They're all in their 90s. Not the freedom fighters whose name you read in the books, textbooks, who became prime minister and president and stuff like that, but ordinary people who stood up, took arms against the British, fought for your freedom, allowing you to be in. Sit here today in a free discussion where we can openly espouse our ideas and exchange them. The most of your free, how many of you have met, sat with, and had a conversation with a living freedom fighter who took part in a major action before 1947? Well, you know, I'm going to start asking you who and what conversation. But anyway, there are only three hands up. The next generation will not even have that opportunity. 5 years from now, they're dead. They're all gone. This may, my colleagues and I, there are several of them here doing all the filming and stuff. My colleagues and I recorded two freedom fighters in Sangli. One was 101 years old. And still farming. He took 45 quintals of sugarcane from his half acre in this Rabi season. Okay? And the other is 97 years old and whizzes about 20 kilometers a day on his bicycle. You're talking about a generation that will never be, the like of which will never be seen again. Many of these people were part of a historic uprising in this state called the Prati Sarkar. In the 1940s, a group of people, calling farmers and laborers, took over Satara, which was then a very big area, including Sangli district, and attacked British trains, British treasuries, British armories. And the money they looted, they distributed to the starving people of 43 famine. Remember, famine was in Bengal, yes, but it affected the rest of the country with food prices, with food being rushed towards Bengal. A group of people in this Prati Sarkar, the armed wing, was called Tufan Sena. And the founder of that Tufan Sena was a man called Ramchandra Shripati Lad, known underground as legendary at that time, Captain Bhav, Captain Elder Brother. One of the people we interviewed 2 years ago, 2016, we found him, he was 94, Captain Bhav. He had led the biggest attack on a rail, on a train, the greatest train robbery in India, when they hit the Bombay Mirage special goods train carrying the payroll of the British Empire for Bombay Presidency. And they lifted that and they distributed it amongst the peasantry and the people and for the expenses of the Prati Sarkar underground. It was led by a man called Nana Patil, who became a member of parliament immediately after defeating the major political parties. He stood on the undivided Communist Party's ticket. And supported by the Communist Party and the PWP, which were together in those days. I want you to see Captain Bhav talking about the great train robbery. The old man is a warrior at 95. He would have turned 96 on June 22nd. And he's a warrior. And he believes that the spirit is still alive of that great time, Captain Bhav. Yeah. Can we lower the lights a bit?
Ramchandra Shripati Lad. मला कॅप्टन भाऊ या नावानं सगळीकडे फरितीस करताना मी मारो 1942 स्वातंत्र्याच्या चळवळीमध्ये वयाच्या 15-16 वर्षी मी सामील झालो आणि त्यामुळं स्वातंत्र्य लढ्यामध्ये लढायचं भाग्य मला लाभलं आणि त्या लढाईत या देशाला स्वातंत्र्यही मिळालं त्या गोष्टीचं अत्यंत समाधान असताना
the streets in protest on the MLA. At age 95, Captain Bao came out on the streets and marched with them for a kilometer. He said, then also we fought for farmers and laborers, now also we fight for farmers and laborers. Yeah. One of the most beautiful things he said, we have a full story on him along with the video on the website of the People's Archive. One of the most beautiful things he says, We fought for independence and freedom. We achieved independence. It is such a powerful remark. We fought for independence and freedom, we achieved independence. There are 7-8 others like him. There are maybe a couple of hundred across the country. Go on to Paris and look for foot soldiers of freedom. You'll find the Adivasi woman, Salihan, who led an uprising against the British in 1932. She died now, a few years ago. You'll find Lakshmi Ponda, the Odia woman from rural Odisha, who was the only woman from Odia woman to be there during the action in the INA of Subhash Chandra Bose in Burma. This whole, and who also went to Singapore. I mean, she was not a fighter, but she was part of the logistics team, but she trained to fight. The one possession she had was her photograph with her rifle. And she would not be given recognition for it. She fought all she didn't want the pension, she didn't want anything. She wanted to be recognized as having fought for her country's freedom. Well, we did stories, we did all that. She actually was recognized. In some ways it became a bit hilarious because the Odisha governor would send her every Republic Day and Independence Day the invitation to come to the Raj Bhavan and include two special car passes. She lived in a slum and she said the only thing I ever had to do with cars was my late husband drove one for 2 years as a driver. When the day after it was said that she would get the recognition, that week she passed away because it was what she had been waiting for. This is the noblest chapter of your history. The freedom struggle. Okay? What are you taught in your history books? We exist for that. We exist to be a living textbook. How much better to hear Captain Bao tell you your history than some stupid guidebook or some book that went out of print or was somebody's PhD thesis, whatever. Here you have the living history. We're looking at rural India in its ugliness and its beauty, in its barbarity and in its brilliance, every bit of it. Because you have to understand that both exist. You can't embrace one and pretend that the other doesn't happen. One of the things we do, the largest database and project of its kind in the planet. Okay. Oh, by the way, that film was made by four young ladies aged at that time from age between 21 or 22 and 25 or 26. All of them students like yourselves at the time. All of them young, one of them sitting right there, Samyukta Shastri, and one of the others not here, a student of your department, Media and Cultural Studies. I think Shreya, right? Shreya Katyayani. These were the people who made that film. I was the interviewer who angered him by asking him, when did you join the Tufan Sena? He got very angry. He said, damn it, I founded it. What do you mean? you saw him saying, for the information of P.Sainath, I founded this. So he was very annoyed with me. That guy is still... So you have another project we're doing, the largest of its kind. I think the largest database of songs composed and sung by poor women, village women, in one language, Marathi. It's called the Grindmill Songs Project. The grindmill, when you, the chakki at home, The chakki, working at the chakki, that is the cultural space of that poor woman. It is where she can say anything she wants, possibly because the husband is not listening. But she can say anything she wants. She can compose. There are songs in that composed and handed down through generations. There are songs composed by women who are... When we say folk musicians, it's very rare that you can tell the names of ordinary folk musicians. Only those who make it into Bollywood or something like that get a name. We are doing the recordings in such a way that the full credit of every recording is there, that woman, her name, her village, whatever information she wants to share with you. You know, it may be that I am from this community, I am from that caste, all those details we give. In the 1980s, an Indo-French couple did a collection of 1,10,000 transcripts of such songs. Can you imagine what a treasure this we were sitting on without knowing about it, that there were 1,10,000 OVs, as they're called, like Dohas. 1,10,000 OVs composed by poor women in the villages on an astonishing array of subjects. You won't believe how important and powerful those subjects are. And it ranges from every imaginable issue, family, children, abuse, domestic violence, politics. Do you know in these 1,10,000 songs, there are 2,400 composed and sung by Dalit women on Ambedkar, just on Ambedkar. There are only about 200 on Gandhi, but there are 2,400 on Ambedkar. And there are, imagine that an illiterate, poor village Dalit woman in Marathwada sings a song about Ambedkar's writing of the constitution. It challenges your concept of the construction of knowledge. It certainly did for me. And these are powerful, the poetry is brilliant. There is one woman writing about untouchability in such a powerful verse where she says, if I am born again, let me be born as a tulsi plant, because at least that plant receives dignity and respect. Let me be born as a tulsi plant, because the tulsi gets respect. Even in English, it's called holy basin, the tulsi. It's a sacred plant in many, many cultures and religions. So we got this database from the original creators, all except one sound engineer are dead. He is in France. He gave us this. We are going back to the villages. Collaborations welcome. People want to help us do this, welcome. But our managing editor, Namita Vaikar, is leading a team every now and then, trying to discover. That project was done in the 80s. Some of the women are dead. But their daughters-in-law, their granddaughters have performed the songs for us. Okay? And it's called the Grandmill Songs Project. We have published about more than 250 so far. Go and look at it. The Grindmill Songs Project. Let me show you, in fact, where you will find it. And that is the Grindmill Songs Project. Each of these is one edition, and you can see there are many pages. Take this, the demand for equality, the rejection of caste. Okay. Wherever we could, some of the recordings from the past, there were just a few recordings, those were done on, audio. We are now trying to video these songs, and you can just go to the thing and look at the extraordinary number of... It's also led to some very interesting experiences for our teams, because in several families, the grindmill is no longer in the use, it's gone into the attic. So we persuade the lady to bring it out of her attic, and you'll see videos where her grandchildren are sitting and staring at the grandmother. A, they didn't know that grandma could sing, and B, they're wondering what the hell that machine is, because now everybody's using electrical appliances. And you will find several of, you'll find hundreds of those songs here. So this is one of our biggest projects. It is the biggest by far, you can call it a flagship thing. And one of them, which is from the older period, Gangubai Ambore, she was thrown out of her paternal home and abandoned by her husband because she developed leprosy. So then she went and stayed in a broken down temple, lived there and wrote songs, some of which are identifying with Sita abandoned in the forest. Just listen to a minute or two of Gangubai Ambore. You've got 250 songs, most of them with videos published up there. And by the way, this last week, 1 week ago, we launched our podcast, Spari Podcast. And I will tell you that your colleague Himanshu from Media and Cultural Studies was the pioneer of that podcast in our empire. The point is that Pari is not just a platform for reading stuff, it's where you can engage with your society, with its culture, with its histories, with in making your media much more meaningful, making your journalism and content of it much more meaningful. But we are also collecting other skills. I will show you one song from the East, one song from the South. But we also look at the extraordinary skills of ordinary people. In Kerala, which has 44 rivers and a huge amount of boat traffic, Not many people know that many of the boats sailing in Kerala's rivers are 80 years old and even 100 years old. They are repaired and kept afloat by an extremely skilled group of people who are dying out. The boat repairmen of Kerala. But the reason why we have done a 17-minute documentary on them, of which you see 60 seconds, is their speciality is that they are all musicians. They don't take a break from work and do the music. The work is the music. With their hammers, with their spanners, with their chisels, they form a percussion band. Two people working on one boat here, one person working on another boat there, they keep time. Watch. The
ഒരു രണ്ടിരോ ചെയ്ത ആൾക്ക് 2000 രൂപ
ആയപ്പോ I'm very proud to tell you that this year, April and May, the first South Asian Short Films Festival held in Kolkata, 15 short films from Pari were selected. Three or four of them were official selections for the competition section, but all 15 of them were screened in the festival. Many of them were made by people of your age group. Know that. They were made. It means you can do it. They were made. We have very strong ethical protocols about our filmmaking, apart from consent, collaboration, context, all of that. But one of the things you will see, you will never see the filmmaker in the film. You're going out to make a film on an artisan. That film is, the focus of that film at all times is that artisan. We don't want the filmmaker to come on. Yeah. So, there are rare instances where someone is shouting a question across 400 meters in a flood. That's the first thing, you hear your voice. But speaking of singers and the ferment in rural India, every region in this country has its own bards, the poets and singers of the people, for the people. Here from Odisha, in the POSCO, anti-POSCO agitation, a singer, again, a Dalit, landless, part-time laborer, part-time fisherman. His name is Purna Das. And he composes this incredible song in the struggle again for the protection of the lands of his village, which were eventually rescued. They managed to defeat POSCO. And you can see Purna Das. The astonishing thing about this song, he composed it on the spot. Extempore. Okay? He composed it on the spot. And we were blessed to be present at that spot at that time. Actually, they came out chasing us because they thought we were police when we landed up there. It's a big problem because I have this habit of wearing khaki trousers. And then they all sat there, and then we asked them, and then Purna Das composed and sang this song. It's an Odia, but you will understand the words, and then. And we have learned a lot from our young filmmakers, one of whom filmed in Bihar. All of you who shoot video know that the greatest bloody problem with video is the audio. In the midst of floods and with huge winds, she managed to get incredible sound by making that person, by talking to the person on the cell phone and using that as the recorder, backup recorder. And she got a fantastic film, four fantastic films, all of which went to the film festival, two of which went to the film festival. But let me show you another group of young singers from the other end of the country, Young Tribal Project Development School. Kids all below the fifth class, okay? I think first to fourth class. This was also shot on a cell phone by our tech editor, Siddharth Adhikar. It's a most isolated panchayat in southern India, in the peninsular India. It's called Edamalakudi. And the children, there isn't a word of English spoken in the Edamalakudi panchayat. The Mudavans live in the deep jungles of Idukki, in wild elephant territory. It's 23 kilometers trek to the village where we went on foot. No roads are allowed there for obvious and good reasons. And what's your favorite subject? And they all say English. So then I said, you know, by the way, it's a very dumb question. Each time we do this, I feel stupid going and asking what's your favorite subject. Kids are smart people. They will look at what the first answer that the first two give. If those two don't get punished for it, then everybody will say the same. So if you say math and we don't punish you, then all the other kids will say math. But anyway, they said English, so I challenged them. I said, let me see some English. They sang me this song, and I do not accept I do not accept responsibility for the lyrics. I can only clarify that no potatoes are grown within a 50 kilometer radius of this village. They grow yam in that area, but no potatoes. But they sing like angels. And incidentally, another part of our video protocols, first credit goes to the performer, not to the director of the film. First credit goes to those whose story is being told. Story and narrator, or story and singer. The first and major credit of our credits line goes to them. It's not appropriated by us. But here you are. Class, we asked them, we told the boys, I mean, you know, that you've been totally outclassed. What about, what are you going to sing? So they couldn't sing much, but they recited something that really reflects a mindset that has gripped much of India, especially rural India, which is that, you know, in the rural area, the doctor and surgeon are all the same people. So the boys made a reply to the boys replied to the girls, I mean to show us that they also knew English. I did not believe that it was possible to have more insane lyric than that one. But the boys succeeded. They are basically telling their doctor, I have a stomachache, I need an operation. Found some of the greatest and most brilliant things that we have come across. In that same region on the other side of the border, in the Coimbatore Hills, we came across things that we didn't know, don't know happen in these fantastic schools. There's a school called Vidyavanam, which literally means knowledge in the forest. And Vidyavanam students, 53% of them are Irula tribes. So very, very poor and deprived tribe. 15% of them are Dalits. The school, for them, the school is free. Okay? And what a difference where it makes when you have not a training, but an education. Volunteer teachers come from all over the country, from Ambedkar University, from Santiniketan, and teach those children music, song. These kids have never left the block of Coimbatore block, but they know a hell of a lot more about their country than a lot of schools in the elite, children in the elite schools elsewhere. Can you believe they had an annual debate? And after this, I'm going to show you the pages of Pari. And they had every year an annual debate. I got dragged into preside over their debate. I hate school debates, ever since I was in school, where someone will, you'll be asked to discuss, is ahimsa relevant today, and, that sort of thing. For 15 minutes, these kids, I'm only going to show you a little snippet, guess what they discussed, something that you have never seen a serious discussion on your television ever, maturely, seriously. They debated without prompting, no teachers, the stage is empty with them, just them. I sat on the floor in front. They, 15 minutes, they debated. Okay, you can prepare for a debate, but not for supplementaries and questions and polemic. They debated genetically modified crops. The oldest child there was 13. the oldest child ever studied, and they debated genetically modified crops. And just watch them. They had a moderator who was actually moderate. And they covered every important aspect of the GM debate. Original varieties, hybrid, BT, GM. They had gone, that school keeps 4,800 books for the children. Many of those children come from homes where there are no books and no one knows how to read. Please remember that the children you are looking at are first generation English speakers. And look at the talent. You can see the full debate on Bali. They covered everything. Hybrids, straight line varieties. They quoted from US Department of Agriculture reports on monarch butterflies and what has happened. Like in India, you're having a problem with bees. Okay? It's astonishing. These kids they didn't get this from a television channel or something. They read in their 4,800 book library and spoke to people about it. They spoke to their teachers. I was just blown away by that they learn. The education part comes in, the experiential education. Their theme that year was rice. They were discussing golden rice. The theme of their exhibit, the whole semester, they learned about rice. And they learned about it by cultivating 5 micro plots of rice of different varieties. Their parents came to help them. They are agricultural laborers and farmers, the marginal farmers. From them they learned and they did it. What astonishing thing these children, any children, are capable of given that opportunity. Okay? That's the difference between education and a training. From 25 years ago, I use a different term. I never use the word highly educated anymore because 30 years ago, when I was working in the Weekly Blitz, I went to a meeting of Mr. Balasaheb Thackeray in the Crystal Room at Taj, organized by people from NRIs from Harvard Law School, Harvard Business School, Harvard whatever. And they sat and clapped and whistled and stamped the floor in approval as he said one horrible thing after another about every other community. That day I went home and I had to write my column, and I decided that these people are not highly educated, they are expensively educated. This is what Pari's pages look like, okay? This is what, say, the front page of Pari looks like. This, 3 times Hindu, came back as Hindu. Then she's holding her cards and showing you her original name and what has been printed on it, okay? So, that is your Aadhaar. And many, many such stories on what the Aadhaar has done to different people and different situations. This is the podcast that Himanshu helped us set up from the long march of the farmers from Nashik to Mumbai. So you can hear the voices, the comments from all of us in conversation with those farmers. That's our inaugural podcast. This is our online library, the only online library dedicated wholly to rural India. Not only do we put on any report connected with rural India, even if there is urban India in it, if it has rural India, it will go up there. But we do all of you a favor. You can't summarize an 800 page report, but you can write a 200 word focus. What is the report about? What is the focus of the report? That value added comes in that one of the huge problems as teachers here know is getting students and researchers to correctly cite a document. So we give you all those, the copyright, the names, who are the members of this commission, who wrote this report, and we give you the 10 most important facts from the report. So by looking at it, you can decide, is this the report I need to read or not? Okay, so it's a unique library, it will be renamed as library, and the person putting that value together for you is here, Subhuhi Jivani, who is our librarian. And this is the project that the largest number of young people participated. By the way, I want to tell you something more about the People's Archive. Know this, that the overwhelmingly there is greater coverage, not just equal coverage, but there is overall greater coverage of women and women's labor than there is of men. Second, out of the 127 photographers who have contributed photographs to Pari, 65% are women. Out of the 120 or 130 odd authors who have written for Pari, more than 50% are women. And our analytic is that the largest single group spending the most time on Pari is women in the age group 18 to 24. So we have a dream of covering every single region of this country. There are 95 in my count. So like Malabar is a region, Bundelkhand is a region, Marathwada is a region, Bundelkhand is a country-sized region. So we call it two regions. We try keeping one Pari fellow in the, we haven't been able to afford to do many, but we need to do about 100 fellows. We don't have the money. Please contribute to Pari. We don't take money from corporations. We don't take money from governments. We do not carry advertising. Okay? That gives you a completely independent medium. That gives you a completely independent medium. Help us, support us. There is no subscription fee. You don't have to pay anything to go and read anything. And we welcome you as students and teachers to download this material and use it with proper, appropriate acknowledgement. That's all. You are not obliged to pay us a damn thing for it. This content is free for you and for everyone who can go up there to the net. Every year, millions of children are getting into high school and only a percentage of them get into college. Increasingly, education is being privatized. Increasingly, it's being privatized. Increasingly, children can't afford the textbooks. You all know of the famous 2015 Delhi High Court case where the Delhi court ruled that the students of Delhi University had the right to photocopy chapters of books that were out of print or too expensive to buy. If that is the case for the richest university students, with the richest students of any university in the country, imagine your colleagues in Marathwada or Vidarbha or Nashik. What kind of textbooks can they afford? Pari is a living textbook. On one hand, we are a living journal. We were the only ones who began coverage of the Long March. When that march started in Nashik, there was only the Pari fellow, Parth MN. And by the way, 2 weeks ago, he won one of the biggest awards in journalism, the European Commission's Journalism Prize, for a story he did in Pari. And so, one of the most beautiful projects we have, in 2011-12, before Pari was born, I started getting worried about the attacks on Northeastern students in Delhi and Bangalore, rapes, molestations, and one comment of one of the villains who was part of the attack in the INA market in Delhi, that statement of his never left my mind. Asked, why did you do this? He said, they look Chinese. Terrible crime. You have to look Chinese. And then you know what happened with the African story. So then this came to all of us in Pari, the pre-formation group. Who looks Indian? And is there such a thing as an Indian face? We discovered there are 1.3 billion Indian faces, and they are astonishingly diverse. So we decided to map the facial diversity of the country. And so you can imagine, from the Jarawas of the Andamans to the Pandits of Kashmir, the sheer incredible diversity of the Indian population. So pick there and tell me that this looks like an Indian. The other thing is that you will find that many of the faces could be out of Latin America, they could be out of Africa, they could be anywhere. It's such a gigantic diversity. But we don't just put a face. We insist, our understanding and approach to the photography is, first, concept. Second, context. Third, collaboration. Fourth, creation. Increasingly, we are trying to get, not just cover the marginalized communities, but to get them to do journalism. That also I will show you. We have had Adivasi workers in the Bandipur forest. Believe me, they shot photo essays for us that Nat Geo cannot do for you. They may not have the same technical excellence of any of us as professional photographers, but they see the world through such different eyes that they capture something that you and I could never have thought of. The faces, if you look at the faces, now the A, B, C, D, all of that means all the districts starting with A. Yeah, so this is a mendicant musician who was performing at the source of the Godavari River, which had run dry in 2016 in Nashik. He himself is from Akola, a village called Akole, from a village called Akole in Ahmednagar. When we started this, we asked young students and others to contribute the photograph. It'll have, every photograph has data in it. Who the person is, which village, which district, which taluka, whatever, plus occupation. If it's a child, what are the parents' occupation? And we found that young people responded massively. But it had a huge impact on those taking the photographs, because we insisted on all that data means you have to sit and engage with that person. You don't take it from a passing vehicle. Many of our young talent taking these photographs wrote to us, phoned me up, said, "I was shocked to hear that lady agricultural laborer story. Can I write a larger article for you?" It created that much more sensitivity in the photographer. And it's something that anyone can do on their cell phones, anything. We insist on a certain quality. So you have three young guys in Kerala, on seeing the first PARI demo in 2014, took their holidays. They were students of journalism in Kochi. They took their holidays and they boarded three state transport buses and went in different directions of Kerala, talking to fishermen, to laborers, to singers, to poets, to toddy tappers, to all that sort of thing. And it had a transformational effect on them by learning so much more about their society. So the FACES project, again here, by the way, the number of women photographers vastly outnumbers this. And we have worked formally with universities. Last year, Ashoka students, Ashoka University students shot and covered. We got so ambitious when people responded so well, we stopped only shooting three faces in every district. We said, let's cover every block in the country. There are 8,000. The only state we have completed is Goa, because there are only 12 blocks. But they covered 67 blocks in Haryana. It's not an easy thing to do. And to be able to talk to those people, engage with them, sit in their homes, find their stories. So the FACES project is one of our great ones. This is Paris coverage of that long march to, the long march that took place from Nashik to Mumbai. This is the latest story done by an undergraduate. Okay? It's a beautiful story on a library that serves young Muslim women in the outskirts of Mumbai, so to speak. We have a section on urban India called the rural in the urban, migrants in the cities. So that's who these people are. Some of these girls are from Jharkhand. And that's why it's called the Library of Long Journeys. It's a beautiful story written by a girl in her second year of BA. Have a look at it. And these are all the different categories. Things we do is labor. Things we make is artisans. Farming. Little video clips. The rural in the urban. Women, Dalits, Adivasis. It's endless. There's a huge amount of stuff on this. And please look at the People's Archive of Rural India. Please use the People's Archive of Rural India. Please collaborate with the People's Archive of Rural India. And please know that we publish in 12 to 13 languages. People translate for us and we carry. Captain Bao's article is in 13 languages. The Long March of the Dispossessed, which you saw there, that is in several languages itself. Say, you go here, you look at the languages, okay? English, you click on that. That same article is published in all those languages. In English, Urdu, Hindi, Odia, Tamil, Marathi, Bengali, Punjabi, and Assamese. Multilingual in India means English and Hindi. We believe that languages are at the soul of, in the core of rural India. These are the people who keep those languages alive. So we need help and we need contributions. We do this without charging you a single paisa. If people want to go up, you can go through InstaMojo and contribute to the People's Archive. We will distribute bookmarks with the URLs in the different languages. Okay? And I think we have shot our time quite a bit. But if you have the time, you want to ask me questions, I'll take three at a time and then try doing something. Can we do? Or? Okay, 10 to 15 minutes. Three questions and we'll do it. And thank you. There were three exemptions that are listed in the statement of revenue forecast. One is direct corporate income tax. Second is customs duties waivers. And third is excise duty waivers. Apart from that, there are thousands of other waivers at the state government level, at the panchayat level. There are various exemptions that you give in the name of increasing jobs, which never actually happens. That waiver, that entire thing was incentives to industry. That was the basis.
So my second question is about the media that short films that you have shooted about that Bhunkia Panchayat of Godinpur and Postco. I belong to that area. So, particularly that district. So, but you said the credit goes to the person and.
Yeah.
So, does that person know?
I mean, not only does he know, he was the first person we sent the DVD to, and we sent it to him through Abhay Sahu, who was the leader of that agitation. Abhay Sahu took the DVD from me, and they played it at many meetings, he told me, like an anthem. Yeah, now someone else will ask a question. Will, yeah?
You said that your liberal policies are helping a certain class of people, and middle class is also getting help. And that is the narrative. The downtrodden are at the bottom and they are getting marginalized. why the narrative is always that before 90s it was all bad and after 90s it became like, yeah, the world.
Yeah, it's a question I'm often asked. You see, the thing is, I find it fascinating that the people who say that before 90s everything was bad and post 90s everything is grand, the neoliberal narrative, I'm old enough to tell you that these are the very people who were upholding the earlier regime. The classic example is your late Prime Minister Narasimha Rao. I knew him personally, my family knew his for 50 years. The greatest, the draftsman of all Congress policies in the so-called socialist era, he was the man who drafted those. Pranab Mukherjee was number two. These two people who upheld the earlier regime, after 91 they become neoliberals and uphold the new regime. My point is that everybody has been very consistent. They have been upholders of regimes. Those of us who were critical of the earlier regime are even more critical of the present regime. It has a lot to do with the political and the politics of the individual and the politics of society as a whole. I would say this, that up to 91 or so, if you look at who the Indian intelligentsia were, who the Indian intellectual was, or intelligentsia, more broadly speaking. Historically, the Indian intelligentsia have always been, in my understanding, left of center from the time of Gautama the Buddha. Okay? They have always been left from Buddha, from Ashoka down to Gandhi. And the radicalism of Ambedkar. Do you know that when I spoke to you about inequality, the greatest speech on inequality ever made in an Indian legislature was made on November 25th, 1949 by Baba Saheb Ambedkar when he handed over the draft constitution. He said, I do this in trepidation. We are entering a world of paradoxes where there is democracy in politics, but there is no democracy in and no equality, equality in politics, but no equality in democracy, in society and economy. And the tension between these two will blow up our finely crafted democracy. A truer word was never spoken. So up to the 90s, you find that the Indian intelligentsia somehow fall into the left of center. Now, I am from Andhra Pradesh, okay? I cannot name a great right-wing author or poet. Same in the 3 weeks, 4 weeks that I spent in Punjab, I found the same thing. No. So, but 91 has a number of, that is also the, for many people, the collapse of a socialist dream. Many who put their eggs in one basket, they were left. And you find after that, I find that some of my most radical contemporaries on campus are the pillars of establishment today. So this happens. I mean, it is in the nature of politics and political development. Yeah.
Hello. Sir, I have two questions. You can answer them together only. Why don't we have a single, one media house which will, mainstream media house, which is showing this? Why don't we have one single media house? And how can we, as an individual and institute, contribute to this?
Okay. Number one, I fear you are about to have one single media house in the most negative sense of the term, because the richest man in this country is also the biggest owner of media in the country. Mr. Ambani, as I said a couple of years ago, another 5-10 years we might all be working for Mukesh Ambani. You know, your ETV Marathi, ETV Urdu, they are not owned by Inadu of Andhra Pradesh, they are owned by Mukesh Ambani. Only the Telugu channels
are owned by Ramoji Rao of Inadu. Quietly, 5-6 years ago, all those channels were purchased by, they set up an independent media trust. Well, you know, I suppose with $16.9 billion, you can be very independent. Total value, $40.1 billion. Total value. 16.9 is what he added in 12 months. The same person owns about half of every goddamn news channel that I can think of. Okay? And there is no, the number of media owners is, look, do you know who your journalists were historically? How many people sitting here? How many young people sitting? I found to my shame, even in Punjab, we celebrate Bhagat Singh as a revolutionary, as a martyr. We do not know that Bhagat Singh was a professional journalist. He wrote in 4 newspapers. How many of you knew that? Which newspapers did he write in? Which newspapers did he write in?
Nojawan.
No, I'm saying the fact is, we don't know. Be honest, we don't know. If we knew that he was a journalist, we'd know which paper he wrote for. Okay, but why don't those things happen in a single media house? Sometimes they do. When the media are diverse, they will happen. As the diversity reduces, as concentration happens, as corporatization of media happens, the space disappears. Much of this kind of journalism was what I did in the Hindu. It was what I did, even in the Times of India, it's what I did in the front page. That was another era, another period. When I entered journalism, there were more spaces. The process of corporatization is killing out diversity completely. There is no space. Some of the finest journalists in this country are jobless. Telegraph lays off 700 people. The Hindustan Times closes 6 editions. Now I'm told the Hindu is planning to lay off 500 people. They've already laid off 13 in Kerala. Okay, or they don't lay them off, they'll ask them to leave. Okay? So, ownership of the media, you know who were your media? Bhagat Singh was a journalist. Ambedkar was a journalist. Gandhi was a journalist. How many journalists do you know who can claim to have had 100 volumes of selected works published? Both of the only two people I know are Ambedkar and Gandhi. Who did that? 100 volumes of works, selected works published. And they both opened newspapers and ran them under colonial tyranny. They managed to run those newspapers. They had their newspapers shut down sometimes. These were your journalists. Today, who are your journalists? Please don't answer the question. So that is the huge trend, and that's why you need diversity. You want, what can you do? There are 8-9 things that we can all do. Yeah, but they have to be done collectively and individually, not just individually. We need, for instance, to break the whole, we have to entirely eliminate monopolies in media. In fact, we have to eliminate monopolies in every sphere. But please know that there is a solid legal basis for that precedent, for that. 2 press commissions in the history of the country, both of them said, the biggest threat to press freedom, the papers presented there, said the biggest threat to press freedom comes from business ownership of the press. Okay? Papers were presented in these 2 press commissions suggesting delinking business houses from journalism. All this is part of your history. And the heads of those press commissions were retired Supreme Court judges. They were not flaming left-wing radicals. I'm pleased to tell you that one little piece of good news is that if Justice Ranjan Gogoi, actually the government allows him to be the next Chief Justice of India, which we don't know, he made a terrific speech at the 75th Diamond Jubilee of the Assam Tribune in Guwahati, where he says corporatization has changed the game and nature of the media. He says, the prior restraint has been replaced by self-censorship. I broke the story on paid news in 2009 in this city, in the Hindu, when I showed how much Ashok Chavan claimed to have spent and what he had actually got for the
few thousand rupees he spent. I had a senior journalist of the Marathi press ring me up and say, very fine journalist whose integrity can never be questioned, said, tomorrow you're going to see a story on my paper with a senior cabinet minister. It'll have my byline on it. I did not write it. It's all paid news. Because he said, what do you expect me to do? I am on an 11-month contract. When you and I started in journalism 30 years ago, both of us had the protection of the Working Journalists Act. Today, all the media houses are violating the Working Journalists Act. You cannot, you have a law which gives us tenure, and then you have contracts which break the law. He said, I'm on an 11-month contract, Sainath. I'm in the 8th month of my contract. I'm paying EMIs of 30,000 on my house. I'm paying 20,000 EMIs on one child's education. Another child has left the college, is looking for a job. I've got a sick mother in hospital. And when told your name will come on this, don't bother, the work has already been done by a PR agency. By the way, worldwide, public relations and journalism, public relations is vastly overtaking journalism. Jobs in public relations are growing at the rate of 3-to-1 for jobs in journalism. And that's apart from all the many journalists who anyway act as PR agents. So that is the dilemma. So one, you need to break monopolies. Two, you need to enforce the Working Journalists Act. Three, we need to have laws to mandate diversity. And I don't just mean in newspapers and voices. I mean, by the way, the Indian media are the most exclusionist body of Indian democracy. Okay, Dalits in this country have been presidents of India. They've been chief ministers of states. They've been governors of many states. They've been vice chancellors of many universities. They've been chief justices of the Supreme Court. But find me one chief sub-editor who is a Dalit in the newspaper in the city. You have excluded them. We have excluded Dalits and Adivasis from, and all generally, all marginalized communities from the media. The media have an incredibly strong upper caste bias. By the way, in our fellowships which we are trying, we have placed ourselves under the mandate that the number fellowship body must reflect the social demographic of India. That means there must be, if there are 100 fellows, there must be 8 Adivasi fellows minimum, there must be 16 Dalit fellows, there must be 50 women fellows. Right? You have to break it in that in those ways also. Four, we need to strengthen the public broadcasters, not government broadcasters. They have to be reclaimed as public broadcasters. There was a period when Somnath Chatterjee was Speaker of Parliament, when Lok Sabha and Raj Sabha TV were the best TV channels in this country in terms of political discussion. You agree? Yeah. Now, so I'm saying it showed us that there was a glimmer in public broadcasters that could be built on. So there are a number of things you can do. Also, put your money where your mouth is. If every one of you is not supporting 2 or 3 ventures, like maybe subscribing to an EPW or a Frontline, if you're not putting your subscription, if you're not putting your money where your mouth is, don't complain to me, don't bellyache about the media, I don't want to hear it. What are you prepared to do about it? So individually you can do that. Subscribe to those ventures. We don't even have a subscription. We're asking you to contribute to allow us to give you that kind of chance.
सर मैं बिहार से आता हूँ और कुछ दिनों से मैं कोशिश कर रहा था जानने का कि 70 साल हुए हैं और बहुत सारे गवर्नमेंट्स बिहार में हैं, ये लैंड डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन को लेके क्यों अभी तक स्क्यूड है और बिहार के केस में ऐसा देखा जाता है कि बाय इकोनॉमिक डेवलपमेंट बोला जा रहा है कि लोग लैंड छोड़ के जो लैंड लॉर्ड थे वो प्रोडक्टिव मीन्स पे जा रहे हैं, अदर शॉप्स क्रिएट कर रहे हैं, मार्केट क्रिएट कर रहे हैं, फिर भी बिहार में लैंड डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन की बात नहीं हो रही है, जस्ट ओनली थ्री दिस कैन बी लॉर्ड
हियर। वेल आई विल आंसर दैट एंड आई थिंक वी विल हैव टू क्लोज द मीटिंग विद दैट, बट इट अलाउज मी टू टेल यू अबाउट, आई एम नॉट, आई एम अ जर्नलिस्ट, आई एम आल्सो अ सिटीजन एंड आई हैव द राइट to make demands of my constitution, of my government, of my state. वो सिर्फ बिहार में नहीं है जो प्रॉब्लम आप बता रहे हैं. दो तीन राज्य छोड़ के लैंड फॉर लैंड रिफॉर्म दूसरी जगह में हुआ नहीं. सबसे पहला एक्ट जो हुआ अर्ली 40s में एबोलिशन ऑफ जमींदारी एक्ट हुआ. अभी भी आप देखिए जितना सरप्लस लैंड पड़ा है सरकार के पास, स्टेट के पास, जो डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन जिसका डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन हुआ नहीं, 90% जो लैंड डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन हुआ वो हुआ केरल, बंगाल, त्रिपुरा और जम्मू एंड कश्मीर. शेख अब्दुल्ला ने कुछ सिर्फ वैली में, जम्मू नहीं किया लेकिन वैली में किया. लेकिन वो लैंड रिफॉर्म फ्रॉम अबव, जो बाकी आया था वो फ्रॉम बिलो, पीपल मूवमेंट्स ने एक सरकार बना के लैंड रिफॉर्म किया. अभी लैंड रिफॉर्म का मीनिंग ही बदल गया. आप न्यूज़पेपर पढ़ो, लैंड रिफॉर्म का मीनिंग यह है कि मेक इट इजियर फॉर कॉर्पोरेशंस टू बाय लैंड, फ्रीइंग एग्रीकल्चरल लैंड. ये है मतलब जो जो शेतकरी और मजदूर जो बैठा है वहां, वो सब जेल में पड़ा है लैंड. देर मेड लैंड प्रिजनर्स. इसका मतलब लैंड रिफॉर्म इज वन ऑफ द बिगेस्ट अनफिनिश्ड एजेंडास ऑफ दिस कंट्री एंड यू कैन नॉट सॉल्व मेनी मेजर प्रॉब्लम्स विदाउट दैट लैंड. लैंड रिफॉर्म का मतलब सिर्फ डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन नहीं है, और कुछ बहुत, एक किस तरीका का रिलेशनशिप है, वेजेस का मामला है, सब है, एग्रीकल्चरल लेबरर्स राइट्स भी है उसमें. और मैं समझता हूं कि एग्रीकल्चरल लेबर ऐसा एक क्लास नहीं होना चाहिए, वो सब किसान होना चाहिए. मार्च महीने में इस शहर में एक इवेंट हुआ जहां 40,000 शेतकरी, छोटा किसान, नासिक से मुंबई तक मार्च किया 180 किलोमीटर धूप में. और कैसा आया उसमें, बूढ़ी बूढ़ी औरत, 70 साल का, जिसके पास जूता होता नहीं है, वो भी मार्च करके आया हाईवे पे 40 डिग्री हीट में नासिक से. और यू नो हाउ दे प्रोटेक्टेड देयर फीट, दे सेलोटेप्ड देयर फीट. Many of them, they came with their feet bleeding to the Azad Maidan. Yeah, they sellotaped their feet and came. And aisa ek, they won a brilliant tactical victory in Mumbai. Jo unka final day of march tha, March 12, when they were supposed to march from outskirts of Mumbai to Azad Maidan. Lekin wo cancel karke मार्च 11 रात को मार्च किया. क्यों? बिकॉज द हम्बल मार्जिनल पेजेंट्स एंड लेबरर्स ऑफ नासिक डिड नॉट वॉन्ट टू डिस्टर्ब एंड डिस्टरप्ट द चिल्ड्रन ऑफ मुंबई हु हैड बोर्ड एग्जाम्स ऑन मार्च 12. और जब मैंने उनसे पूछा, जो महिला किसान आए हैं वो मार्च में, ऐसा क्यों किया रात को, व्हेन यू आर एग्जॉस्टेड, अब तक गए, अब रेस्ट क्यों नहीं लिया रात को? और ये जवाब दिया हमको, हमारे बच्चे भी एग्जाम लिखते हैं, व्हाई डू वी वांट टू डिसरप्ट दीज चिल्ड्रन. एंड द इंपैक्ट, उसका इंपैक्ट इतना था कि पहली बार मैं देख रहा हूं मिडिल क्लासेस उनकी सपोर्ट में आया था. और मैं ये कह रहा हूं कि आपको दो डिमांड, मैंने एक अपीस लिखा था, आप देख सकते हैं, लॉन्ग लॉन्ग मार्च ऑफ द डिस्प्रोसेस. पिछले दो साल में हर जगह में ये मेरा रिक्वेस्ट है कि पार्लियामेंट, संसद का एक स्पेशल सेशन, 3 हफ्ते का सेशन होना चाहिए सिर्फ कृषि संकट के ऊपर और रिलेटेड इश्यूज. 3 हफ्ते मतलब 21 दिन, उसमें 3 दिन आप स्वामीनाथन कमीशन रिपोर्ट का डिस्कशन करो, 3 दिन क्रेडिट, कर्जा, इंडेटेडनेस का डिबेट करो, 3 दिन पानी, जो पानी का संकट जो है वो ड्राउट नहीं है, वो मैं कहता हूं मेगा वाटर क्राइसिस, और पानी का बैकडोर से निजीकरण हो रहा है, ट्रांसफर्स फ्रॉम विलेज टू सिटी, फ्रॉम इंडस्ट्री, फ्रॉम फार्मर, फ्रॉम एग्रीकल्चर टू इंडस्ट्री, फ्रॉम लाइवलीहुड्स टू लाइफस्टाइल्स, हर दिन ये ट्रांसफर हो रहा है, पानी लूट हो रहा है। तीन दिन पानी का संकट, तीन दिन महिला किसान का राइट्स। मैं कह रहा हूं आपको कि जो भी लैंड रिफॉर्म प्रॉब कुछ नहीं होगा जब तक हम महिला किसान का जो राइट्स है, अगर हम वो उसके लिए लड़ाई झगड़ा संघर्ष नहीं करेंगे, उसका प्रॉब्लम सॉल्व नहीं करेंगे, तो आपका रिफॉर्म नहीं होगा। तीन दिन कृषि संकट का विक्टिम्स सेंट्रल हॉल ऑफ पार्लियामेंट, ये डिमांड हमारा डेमोक्रेटिक डिमांड्स है। आई वॉन्ट द विक्टिम्स ऑफ द agrarian crisis to stand in the central hall of parliament and tell the nation what is the agrarian crisis, what it has done to us. Teen din aap discuss karo agricultural laborers ka, khet mazdoor ka problem. Teen din aap discuss karo 20 saal ke andar kis type ka agriculture chahiye is desh mein, corporate led agriculture ya community led agriculture, aur usme naya forms of ownership bhi discuss karo. सिर्फ इंडिविजुअल ओनरशिप नहीं, कलेक्टिव ओनरशिप। वो जैसा केरल में वो मूवमेंट है कुटुंबश्री, अब देखिए उसका पोर लैंडलेस वुमेन 4.3 मिलियन मेंबर्स बन गए, वेरी वन ऑफ द ग्रेटेस्ट मूवमेंट फॉर जेंडर जस्टिस एंड पॉवर्टी एलिगेशन। तो ऐसा एक स्पेशल सेशन होना चाहिए, और उसको कंट्रोल करने के लिए 40,000 नासिक से मुंबई आया, मैं कह रहा हूं कि पूरा देश से 10 लाख तक वहां जाना है दिल्ली में संसद को। फिर लैंड रिफॉर्म अनफॉरगॉटन एजेंडास, ये मैं कह रहा हूं कि वो एक डेमोक्रेटिक स्ट्रगल, डेमोक्रेटिक डिमांड, डेमोक्रेटिक मींस और डेमोक्रेटिक रिजल्ट्स आना चाहिए। कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन का डायरेक्टिव प्रिंसिपल्स ऑफ स्टेट पॉलिसी वो होना चाहिए, पार्लियामेंट का डिस्कशन का बेसिस पार्लियामेंट में वो होना चाहिए। Thank you all very much.